And the entire country was shocked. And the entire country pledged we would do something about it, and this time would be different. Shame on us if we've forgotten.
We are back with our first roundtable. Welcome back, everybody. All right, guns, David Axelrod, the president. One thing he's used the bully pulpit for is to try to re-energize this issue of the gun debate. But the polls are sort of speaking pretty loud here. Public doesn't seem to have the same desires.
Well, yes and no. If you look at that same CBS poll you cited, 90% still support background checks. I heard Senator Flake say it's a bridge too far. Well, 90% of Americans have crossed that bridge. 86% are Republicans. And many of them, by the way, are in these suburban swing districts mm-hmm. that are currently held by Republican members of Congress. So I think the politics isn't all that clear on this. And if I were on the Republican side, I would be looking hard at a way to find something that I can vote for that would satisfy desire to deal with this problem.
Tom Davis, you did this for a living. What part of gun control is good politics for any Republican?
It's tough. I mean, it's an intensity issue. The polls measure one thing, but the people who vote on it tend to be the people who don't want the changes at this point. And in the Republican base, which is largely rural, there's no percentage in voting for this in many of these districts.
You know, Peggy, yeah.
I think a big part of this story is that people don't trust Congress. After Newtown, there was a great bubbling feeling of, my goodness, there must be at least some things we can do legislatively to make this whole gun situation better. If the Congress, if the Senate had moved quickly on discrete small bills having to do with background checks, I mean quickly in the weeks after Newtown.
But they were discrete. These are small incremental bills.
Move it quickly. Do it. Don't put it together into this big thing and then start to be talking about all these different kind of guns you're banning and having all these hearings. They fail to move quick and small.
Is she right?
Well, Senate moving quickly, those two things don't go together.
But sometimes you gotta.
But here's my question is whether Michael Bloomberg, with his money and his enthusiasm, can manage to turn this into a voting issue on the pro-gun control side. That's a voting issue for me.
In November. I get that, did you see, that's what we had Mark Pryor. I'm not going to let somebody from New York City tell me, Mary Landrieu, Heidi Heitkamp, they've all used the same wording. These are Democrats who don't seem to be happy with the role Michael Bloomberg.
No, in the short term, I think he's a good foil for them to certify their authenticity
to their
constituents. Yeah. But as I mentioned, in states like New Jersey, Pennsylvania, California, New York, there are members for whom I think this could be an issue, especially if Bloomberg turns up the heat in the upcoming campaign.
You used to do a suburban district. That's right. The one you represented. There is a different type of voter there than there is in a majority of these Republicans.
The problem is there aren't that many districts like that that are still Republican. There are some, and they'll have a vulnerability, and these are the Republicans that are most likely to cross, particularly on background checks. And I think to that extent, the mayor and others add pressure on these members to vote that way.